Good morning, everyone. It's my pleasure today to be with you, and thank you for the invitation. So, can you please start? So, I was asked by Dr. Abdullah to give a talk about the advanced heart failure, and in the next 15 minutes, I'm going to cover what's the advanced heart failure patient, and what's the therapy for advanced heart failure patient, and what's LVAD and transplant. So let's remind ourselves first what the stages of heart failure. We have stage A, patient who at risk for heart failure. Patient have a history of hypertension, cardiovascular disease, diabetes and obesity, or has genetic or familial cardiomyopathy, but patient without current or previous symptoms of heart failure. Stage B, stage B, patient with without current or with previous symptoms and signs of heart failure, and with the structural heart disease, evidence of increased filling pressure, and has a risk factor like increased nitric peptide level, persistent elevated cardiac troponin in the absence of competing diagnosis. Stage C, patient with symptomatic heart failure with current or previous symptoms and signs of heart failure. Stage D, patient with advanced heart failure. So in 2022, the guidelines have been defined advanced heart failure as a marked heart failure symptoms that interfere with the daily patient life with a recurrent hospitalization despite attempts to optimize guideline direct medical therapy. And also there is a universal definition of advanced heart failure with severe symptoms and signs of heart failure at risk, recurrent hospitalization despite guideline direct medical therapy or refractory or intolerance to medication requiring advanced therapy such as consideration for a transplant or mechanical support or palliative therapy. So the European Society of Cardiology defines advanced heart failure with severe persistent symptoms despite GDMT, severe cardiac dysfunction with LVEF less than 30, isolated RV failure, and inoperable severe congenital heart disease or EF of more than 40% with elevated nitric peptide and significant diastolic dysfunction. And patient with hospitalization, recurrent hospitalization, or unplanned visit to the emergency. Or severe impaired exercise capacity with 6-minute walk of less than 300 meter or peak VO2 of less than 12 to 14 ml. So we all know that heart failure patient progress to advanced heart failure stage and it's associated with high mortality up to 75%. And defined advanced heart failure does not necessarily include the LVEF. So LVEF is dysfunction alone is not the meaning of advanced heart failure because it also can be associated with preserved ejection fraction as in a patient with restrictive cardiomyopathy. So the presence of end organ dysfunction, including cardiac cachexia, pulmonary hypertension, also are markers for advanced heart failure, but not necessarily present in all patients. So the AHA, ASA, HFSA guidelines recommended its class 1 indication to in a patient with advanced heart failure when consists with the patient goal of care and timely referral to heart failure specialty care is recommended to assess the suitability for advanced heart failure like LVAD or cardiac transplant or palliative therapy or palliative inotropic support. There is a paper in 2019 that they wrote about focusing on the early referral of patient with advanced stage D patient to the heart failure, to advanced heart failure therapy. And they pre-specified the risk factor, they including systolic blood pressure less than 90, creatinine more than 160, hemoglobin less than 120, and patient with not on ACE or ARBs because of intolerance, because of hypotension, and not on beta blocker. And what they found that patient with zero risk factor, so with zero risk factor, the 1-year survival post-transplant is up to 90%. And the patient also, if considered for LVAD, the survival rate is up to 80%. But with increasing this risk factor, the survival is less and less and less. So why it's important to think about advanced heart failure therapy? because we all know that advanced heart advanced patient, we don't want to reach to the stage when there is an other organ dysfunction like kidney and liver. And also this patient can reach to irreversible pulmonary hypertension and also can reach to will be irreversible frailty result. So prognostication in heart failure is complex and difficult and maybe also change. So early referral to evaluate for advanced therapy, it's really important. So there is a clinical events useful to identify the stage D heart failure, like worsening function status, poor exercise tolerance, like peak VO2 less than 12, 6 minute walks less than 300. Patient will be unable to walk less than one block, had a history of recurrent hospitalization or unplanned visit to the emergency, increasing diuretic requirement. Patient would be intolerant to heart failure medication because of hypotension, because of worsening kidney function, hyponatremia, refractory ventricular arrhythmia, like ICD shocks, recurrent ICD shocks, and cardiogenic shock. And also European Society of Cardiology stated some criteria for advanced heart failure patient that include clinical structure abnormality and function capacity. And to make it easy, there is some use acronym. It's I need help, the I for inotropic support, N for NYHA class, 3 to 4, or high nitropeptide, ejection fraction, end organ dysfunction, D for defibrillator shock, E for escalating diuretic and edema, L for low blood pressure, P for prognostic medication intolerance. So the heart failure patient don't stay in the same place. Unfortunately, when they decline, they fall rapidly. So what current therapy for heart failure? We all know that in 2021, 2022, the guidelines have been updated on the treatment of heart failure. And the American and the European and the Canadian guidelines have been recommended that use of quadruple therapy and for heart failure, use of ARNI, ACE inhibitor or ARBs, beta blocker, SGLT and MRA. Despite all this, but still it's only 50% 5-year survival. And we have also biventricular pacing, it's only 30% 5-year survival. And we have the LVAD, that's 50% 5-year survival. And we all know that post-transplant, the survival rate is 80, and now currently it's 90% survival rate. So what's advanced therapy? We have LVAD as a bridge to transplant or destination therapy. We have a transplant, we have a palliative therapy like use of chronic inotropic support like milrinone or use mitral clip, tricuspid clip. So this, why it's important to use destination, use a bridge to therapy, like use an inotrope as bridge to transplant or LVAD as a bridge to transplant, because that will reduce the admission and also reduce the morbidity. Because our definitive treatment is a transplant or LVAD as a destination therapy. So if patient hospitalized with decompensated heart failure or cardiogenic shock, first of all, we have to check if the patient was optimized on medical therapy or device therapy like CRTD. And if patient was optimized on medical therapy, but he's still on inotropic, he's still inotropic dependent, but not weanable, and not weanable from MCS, we have to consider and evaluate for transplant or LVAD or palliative care. So in 2001, we have the first trial that was called DREAMatch trial. It was a randomized controlled trial. They included 129 patients, including NYHA class 4, patient with contraindication with transplant, age more than 60, history of diabetes, type 1 CKD. They randomized the patient to medical therapy versus LVAD, and what they found that the risk of death was reduced in an LVAD patient by 40%, 48%. And 1 year survival rate in LVAD group was 52%, while on only medical therapy group was only 25%. So left ventricular assist device, it's a valid and alternative in a patient who's non-eligible for heart transplant or just deteriorating while waiting for transplant. So LVAD therapy have been evolved rapidly in the recent years, and the latest generation of device have been improved durability, reduced surgical and hemocompatibility and related complication, and improved patient survival. The most recent devices that was approved by the FDA is HeartMate 3 LVAD. HeartMate 3 LVAD was designed to improve the hemocompatibility and reduce stasis and prolong durability. So we have the biggest trial that was Momentum trial in 2019 was published. Well, they found that HeartMate 3 shown to be not inferior to HeartMate 2 in a term of survival, reduction in hospitalization with significant lower risk of pump replacement because of pump thrombosis. And the incidence of all bleeding event and thromboembolism and driveline infection remained similar and, to the older devices. And they found also 2-year survival rate in a patient receiving the HeartMate 3 are comparable to those after heart transplant, with survival rate have been shown of 80% at 1 year and 70% at 2 year. So the survival rate and survival rate after LVAD as a destination therapy was 80 to 85% at 1 year. So when we consider, and also we have the LVAD as a bridge to transplant, we consider LVAD as a bridge to transplant if a patient are a candidate for a transplant, but he's still waiting on the for heart transplant and the waiting list. But and also in a patient with worsening heart failure with end organ dysfunction, who needs stabilization with LVAD prior to the transplant. Advanced heart failure who, and also in a patient with advanced heart failure who have pulmonary hypertension and needs for LVAD as a bridge to a transplant. So the therapy is heart transplant. We all know that is a gold standard treatment for patient with stage D heart failure. Although we don't have controlled trial that demonstrate or provide improvement in quality of life or function status and longevity if compared with conventional therapy. But the ISHLT have been reporting that the median survival rate post-transplant is 11 to 12 years. So cardiac transplant, we have two common techniques, biatrial technique and bicaval technique. Nowadays, we use bicaval technique. And post-transplant patient will lack of direct sympathetic and parasympathetic innervation. So normally you have tachycardia or heart rate of 100. So a transplant, still they have some contraindication. The age considered, some center they consider, the cutoff of the transplant is 60 and some center consider 65 and some center 70. And Cleveland Clinic, we consider 65 is cut off of the transplant. And also high PVR, active malignancy or infection, excess morbidities like BMI more than 35, poorly controlled diabetes, blood group and sensitization, prior history of surgery or anatomical abnormality. If patients actively substance abuse or actively smoking, also active smoking, it depends from the center to center. Some centers recommend to quit 6 months before considering to be active on the waiting list of the transplant. Some centers they consider they need like to be 1 year stop smoking before considering for a transplant. Inadequate psychosocial support and compliance. But there are some modifiable contraindication like high PVR, active malignancy and infection. If patient treated and he's in remission, needs 5 years at least to be considered before considering for transplant. Excess morbidities like BMI more than 35, usually we advise the patient, we refer them to the bariatric or to dietitian, and we advise them to lose weight before considering for transplant. And blood group and sensitization. Active substance and inadequate psychosocial support and compliance. So the PVR we calculated by mean PA pressure minus wedge divided by cardiac output, normally between 1 to 2 Wood units. Excess more than 3, it's contraindication to transplant because he's a high risk to develop RV failure post-transplant. So what we do if the in the cath lab, if the PVR is more than 3, we do vasodilator challenging. So, and this PVR can be also improved with LVAD. That's why we use LVAD as a bridge to transplant if high PVR, and then we evaluate the patient after 3 to 6 months. So allosensitization, candidate has an antibody against HLA. They develop antibody in, if they have a history of surgery, previous surgery, or recurrent transfusion, or pregnancy. So usually we calculate or we measure the panel reactive antibodies, and this panel reactive antibody we measure every 6 months if a patient actively on the waiting list. And we can see here since a decade that the survival rate have been improved post-transplant. That's because of the current immunosuppression and also current follow-up and management of a patient post-transplant. So it's really important to important the time in managing a heart failure patient. And there is a golden window for the referral for advanced therapy. Like in a patient with NYHA class 3 to 4 symptoms, if a patient unable to tolerate GDMT, recurrent hospitalization, recurrent arrhythmia, ICD shock, worsened renal function. If you have one of this in your patient, always think about advanced therapy. Okay, as we said that NYHA, anemia, and repeat hospitalization. So my take-home message, severe persistent symptoms due to heart failure, consider as stage D, in a patient stage D, consider advanced therapy. Episodes of congestion, hypotension, malignancy, arrhythmia, requiring hospitalization or ED visits, all consider as advanced therapy. Objective of severe cardiac dysfunction, severe impairment of exercise, or above and occur also attempt despite using optimization therapy. Thank you.